关于五角大楼泄露出来以色列要准备袭击伊朗的这个计划，这件事情呢，这两天有一些报道出来。五角大楼自己有否认说他们自己内部有明确的嫌疑人，但是呢，有不少的媒体呢有指出这个人，这个女的名字叫塔巴塔贝，我不知道她中文名字哈，塔巴塔贝，她是在五角大楼工作，而且她是奥斯汀的助手。所以他应该是离奥斯汀本人是很近的，就是美国的国防部长。那么他是有机会，而且是有权限看到一些高级机密的文件的。这个人应该是存在的，这个人应该也是确实是这么一个角色。但是呢，是不是他泄露出的文件现在不知道。有报道，多家媒体报道说他是被 FBI 在调查，但是五角大楼说不是怎么回事儿。现在的情况就是这样，而且这个人，看上去呢，他是早就有人知道的，他不是一个无名的小辈，因为有参议员曾经提出过这个事情，跟奥斯汀说过这个事情，警告过奥斯汀说你要注意这个人，因为主要就是因为他是伊朗裔吧，伊朗裔的美国人，主要是这样，所以这个事情呢，现在的情况是这样。我个人觉得哈，这个泄密这件事情啊，可能确实是泄密的，可能确实不是美国政府有意要把它泄密出来的。从那个泄密的文件里头哈，并没有能够什么东西让我感觉是可以过多的去解读它的。它这个就是一般的这种计划，就是要去攻打一个国家的一个计划。它泄露出来的是两份文件，一份是10月15号泄露出来，一份是10月16号，都是在 Telegram 电报的那个频道上，一个上面的一个频道上面泄露出来的。里面提到了就是他准备要在哪儿发射些什么东西，就是他把他要发射的什么火箭弹或者是什么东西哈，他会在哪儿发射出来？然后呢，16号的那个泄露出来的文件里头提到了核武器，但是呢，他也是隐含着提到，也没有说我们要用核武器，或者说不准备用核武器，或者说是准备在什么情况下，但是呢，给人感觉呢，他是有核武器的，就是这个意思。那这个跟刚刚发生的以色列对于伊朗的袭击有什么关系呢？我觉得没有什么直接的关系吧。你就总体来讲看一下这件事情的前后哈，发生的一些事情，大概其知道会是现在是怎么回事了。10月14号的时候，王毅有跟以色列的外交官有通话。你看时间啊，他是晚上10点多，而且他上头写的是应邀，也就是说，是以色列先联系的王毅，那么王毅跟他打电话。然后他们两个人通话完了以后，1个小时，王毅就马上打电话给伊朗的外交部长。那这个就太明显了，他们是以色列找王毅去传话的啊，这个是太明显了。传什么呢？我跟亚历山大谈话里头，我问过他这个事情哈，我基本上也同意他的判断，就是说以色列的意思应该说我一定要反击啊，我要报复，我不报复的话，跟我国内的人是没有办法交代的，但是会非常有限啊，就是不，他让王毅传的就是给伊朗就是这个意思。那么我完了以后，你就不要再打了，应该是这么一回事儿。那为什么他16号传完了以后没有马上就行动呢？那就是因为18号马上他这个计划就泄露出来了。以色列呢说这个计划现在被泄露出来以后，我们就要推迟。以色列自己是这么说的。那接下来以后呢，22号布林肯就跑到中东去了。布林肯跑到中东去呢，可能他还有别的事情，但是其中的一个原因就应该是这件事情。然后他25号离开的，26号以色列就发生了。就对伊朗发生了袭击，所以情况大致就是这样了。就是布林肯跑到那去跟他再具体再敲定一下，估计呢来来回回说的也就是这意思。你呢要打他可以，但是呢你不要去打他的核设施，不要去打他的炼油设施。估计应该是布林肯的主要目的就是这个。也就是说布林肯原则上是同意他去打伊朗的，但是呢要他要控制，而且呢我认为上一次伊朗去袭击。以色列那一次其实也打得以色列蛮疼的，我觉得以色列自己是没有想到伊朗有这样的实力，而且他自己的铁穹也不行，我表示怀疑萨德能够给他有多少信心，他自己大概对萨德也不是很有信心，所以所有这些因素加在一起哈，不是说他愿意有限的去打击伊朗，而是他的实力摆在那儿，所以现在情况就是基本上就是以色列一次一次打一打，照伊朗的说法没有什么太多的伤亡，现在他只承认有2个士兵。死了，除了这个以外，多数的他自己说都拦截下来。他拦截下来的应该是俄罗斯和东大给他的一些拦截的一些帮助吧，应该是这样。 所以这个事情呢，就大致的情况就是这样，不是，我认为不是特别难理解。如果你把这个事情从头到尾的看一下，它前前后后都发生过什么。我这一后面呢，我就想大家，我就把我跟亚历山大的那个聊话谈话，我们两个这个是10月16号的谈话，你看他解释一下这个事情哈，基本上后面发生的跟他在10月16号预测的也差不多，然后他还解释了一下为什么以色列要通过中国的渠道，而且以色列还跟俄罗斯联系过了，啊，这都是在10月16号以前发生的事情啊。为什么他要以色列要通过中俄而没有让美国去传话？因为伊朗是不相信美国的。他这里面还解释一下为什么伊朗不相信美国。当然，我觉得是不需要解释哈。伊朗肯定不相信美国。不过他就是还是给解释一下，还拿出了证据。你可以看一下，我是加速了一点哈，大概5、6分钟吧，你们也可以再看一下。
Israel Foreign Minister has he called he actually asked the Wang Yi to call him, so he contacted Wang Yi. So Wang Yi had a conversation with him, a phone conversation, and that happened on the 14th, October 14th, at 10:11 in the evening, and almost right after that, the 11:06, right, based on the readout. So Wang Yi called Iranian Foreign Minister Arachi, I think that's his name. So clearly, it's Israel is asking China to pass along some message. Is that how you interpret it? What message does Israel want China to pass along?
Right, what I think what has happened is that Israel has been moving all out for war against Iran. And they'd attacked Hezbollah, they'd assassinated Nasrallah, they'd launched the Pager attack, they'd done all kinds of things. The Israeli army has entered Lebanon, which is fighting and not apparently gaining very much ground. But anyway, that's another story. And then what happened, even as the euphoria and the confidence was bubbling up to the surface, what then happened is that Iran launched its missile strike. All over the media now, the Financial Times, the Daily Telegraph in Britain, many places in the United States, it's suddenly acknowledged that most of the missiles actually, the Iranian missiles actually got through. I'm hearing a report that up to 36 hit one Israeli airbase, the one in Nevatim, which is an important airbase. And yesterday, or was it the day before yesterday, a critically important article in the Financial Times admitting that Israel is out or almost out of air defense missiles, and that the United States isn't able to supply more. So Israel suddenly discovers, my God, the Iranians are much more powerful in military technology than we expected, and the Americans can't step in and help us. And if we find ourselves in a long-term war with Iran, we are going to be exposed to devastating counterstrikes by Iran that we can't counter. So 2 weeks now, more than 2 weeks since the Iranian strike, the Israelis promised a strike. The credibility of Prime Minister Netanyahu and the stability of his government depend on Israel carrying out some kind of a strike against Iran, because they said that that was what they were going to do, and I think their supporters expect them to do it. They don't want to be in a long war. At the same time, they now know that Iran can hit back and hit back hard. So what I think they're trying to do is they want to carry out some kind of strike, but they also want the Iranians not to respond too strongly to it. It's the usual story. So how do they get around this? How do they do that? They contact the Chinese, who they know are good friends with the Iranians. By the way, they've also been contacting the Russians. And they're trying to say, look, we're going to carry out a strike, but it's not going to be quite the big bad strike that we intended at the beginning. We're going to try and do a smaller, precise, lethal, surprising strike. When we do it, can you please not attack us in the way that perhaps you might have done? And if you do that, we'll try and walk away from this whole horrible business. I think that is what is going on. I think that is what the Americans and the Israelis are trying to convey to the Iranians. Now, whether the Iranians are going to listen is, of course, another matter. Whether the Chinese or the Russians are impressed, I think, is another matter again. But anyway, I think that is what the Israelis are trying to say.
Well, but I guess the reason they contacted both China and Russia is because they want to convince the Iranian, right? Because they don't believe only the US pass along the information the Iranian will buy them. Is that what why? Because in the past
Well,
I thought, right? Go ahead.
No, you're completely right. I mean, the Americans have been passing information backwards and forwards between Iran and Israel, and they've been doing it through the Iranian embassy in Qatar. Qatar has been acting as the sort of, conveyor of all of this. But you're absolutely right. American credibility with Iran has completely collapsed. The Iranian president, who spoke to, of all people, Macron, he said this very straightforwardly. Look, when the Hamas chief, Haniyeh, was assassinated in Tehran on the very same day that I was inaugurated president of Iran, we were going to strike back. But then the Americans came, and the Europeans too. And they came and told us, no, don't strike at Israel, because we are going to negotiate a ceasefire in Gaza. And if you strike at Israel, that will prevent that ceasefire from being agreed. So don't do that. Hold back. And the Iranians talked about it with themselves. And they decided that that was what they were going to do. And instead of there being a ceasefire in Gaza, what they got was the pager attack, the attacks on Hezbollah, the advance into southern Lebanon, the assassination of Nasrallah. So, of course, they don't believe. And you know, this is actually there. It's in the Iranian readout of the conversation with Macron. The Iranians don't believe what the Americans are telling them anymore, or the Europeans are telling them anymore. Whereas, by contrast, China, above all, Russia, to a certain extent, are Iran's friends. Iran is going to be meeting with the leaders of these countries in, I think it's 2 weeks' time in Kazan.
Yeah.
So what the Chinese and the Russians say carries credibility. But of course, what the Chinese and the Russians themselves believe now is another matter.
Yeah. 那就先聊到这里，谢谢大家。喜欢我的节目，麻烦点赞、留言、转发、订阅，谢谢。